In this video, we'll discuss about medical emergencies in dental clinic. This is most important long essay or can be asked as short answer. So, the difficulty is to remember the list of medical emergencies. Okay. Remember that the most common medical emergency in dental clinic is syncope. Right. So, first is syncope. After that, you have 3S, that is seizures and stroke. Or these are problems with the brain, right? After that you have 5A, right? Allergic reactions or anaphylaxis, asthma, airway obstruction due to foreign body, and adrenal insufficiency and angina pectoris, right? When you write the angina pectoris, you have to write about myocardial infarction also, because both are related to the chest pain. So, 5A is completed. After that, 5H, hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia. These two are related to the diabetic emergencies. After that, hypertensive emergency, hypotension, right? Related to the BP, hyper or hypo, right? And after that, we have hyperventilation, right? These are the 5H. And after that, you have cardiac arrest and thyroid stone, that is thyrotoxicosis. So you have CT. Remember like this: 3S, 5A, 5H, CT. Right? So almost you have 16 medical emergencies. Then coming to the prevention of medical emergencies, this is common to any medical emergency. First, you have to take good case history. That means he is suffering from any systemic diseases. If so, that systemic condition is under control or not, like that. Proper taking good history, right? After that, you have to follow the stress reduction protocol. If necessary, advise diazepam or alprazolam 0.5 mg before the procedure, before the day of procedure, because to have a good sleep, right? After that, we have to ensure painless treatment. Treatment must be short and it must be painless, right? And then advise proper instructions. That means if he is suffering from some systemic disease, then tell them to bring all the medications they are using, right? And after the procedure also, you have to advise them good instructions and be prepared for the emergency. Okay, so you have to be prepared for emergency. So among these 16 medical emergency, every medical emergency should be discussed in three headings. That is underlying pathophysiology, what is the problem underlying that condition, and how can you diagnose that condition, and how can you manage that condition, right? In management, there are some common points which you can write for any medical emergency. That is, first, stop all the dental procedures. After that, position in comfortable position. That is, position patient in comfortable way. Okay, except syncope, where you are going to place the patient in Trendelenburg position. Generally, a upright position is recommended in all the conditions except syncope, right? And then follow the ABCs. That is airway, breathing, circulation. And we have to administer oxygen, right? And after that, we have to reassure the patient to alleviate any anxiety or further apprehension. And there is definitive treatment, right? That means there are definitive drugs, specific drugs to be given in specific condition. So next time I will discuss the each condition, I am not going to repeat all these things, because you can write all these things in every condition. We are going to discuss only what are the specific drugs to be given in each condition under management. Okay, now we'll discuss one by one. First, we'll see syncope. Okay, what happens in syncope? Due to the pain or anxiety or stress, there is sudden increased release of epinephrine or cortisol in the body, right? That is sudden increase of catecholamines and cortisol, right? Cortisol makes the tissue sensitive to the action of epinephrine. Due to the action of epinephrine in skeletal muscles, that is acting on the beta 2 receptors, that makes vasodilation in the arteries of skeletal muscle, and along with the vasodilation, it makes reduction in the peripheral vascular resistance. Because of these two factors, that is decreased peripheral vascular resistance and vasodilation. Due to these two factors, skeletal muscles located in peripheries, there is pooling of the blood, right? Pooling, peripheral pooling of the blood. Because the blood is pooled in the peripheries, there is decreased venous return to the heart. So when there is decreased venous return, the cardiac output will be reduced. When there is decreased cardiac output, then there is decreased cerebral flow, that is brain flow, brain blood flow. So obviously that will lead to the syncope. This is the exact mechanism what happens in this. Epinephrine can cause vasoconstriction or vasodilation depending on which receptors it is acting. If it activates beta 2 receptors, then it will result in vasodilation. If it activates in the alpha 1 receptors, then it will result in vasoconstriction, right? So in syncope, the patient will feel warmth feeling, that is feeling of warmth and sweating on forehead, nausea, cool extremities, cool and calm extremities, and ultimately it will lead to the unconsciousness. These are the features by which you can recognize syncope, right? Generally, syncope is the most common medical emergency, and it is generally doesn't require any treatment except take the measures to increase the blood flow to the heart by doing trundling bar position, that is legs elevated position, so that the venous return to the heart will increase and cardiac output increases, and it will result in greater cerebral flow, right? If not improved, then you can give the aromatic spirit of ammonia. It acts as a respiratory stimulant, right? With these measures, syncope will resolve. After that, we have seizures, that is epilepsy. The triggering factors are toxic reactions to drugs. It includes local anesthesia also. Local anesthetic drugs reactions are infection, fever, anxiety, or pain. These factors can trigger the seizures. Repeated attacks of seizures is nothing but status epilepticus, right? That is a severe form of epilepsy. So how can you diagnose? There is prodromal symptoms, that is called as aura. That means confusion or anxiety. Patient may feel confusion or anxiety. After that, you can notice generalized convulsions. Okay, generalized convulsions. And that may lead to the unconsciousness also. Right? In this case, your first priority is to protect the patient from any sharp objects or from fall from the dental chair. Right? After that, you are going to give diazepam 10 or 20 mg. IV or IM. If IV is not detected, IV line is not there, then you can give the intramuscular injection also, right? But IV is preferred one, diazepam. This is about seizures. After that, stroke, that is cerebrovascular accident. Due to the thrombosis, hemorrhage or embolism occurring in the blood vessels, right? There is focal brain damage. In the stroke, there is focal brain damage due to the thrombosis or embolism or anything. Okay. Depending on the part of the brain which is damaged, you have the symptoms. You may have hemiplegia, weakness, or hemianesthesia of the body. Depending on which part of the brain is damaged, you have the symptoms. Right? There is nothing you can do it in a stroke except due to giving supportive measures, that is comfortable position or giving oxygen, like that only. There is nothing we can do in an emergency manner. We have to shift the patient to the hospital. Okay. Next one is allergic reactions. Okay. If a first dose of allergen is exposed, then this allergen could be the food or could be any drug. Okay. The mast cells and basophils in our body get sensitized to that allergen. Okay, so the first dose of allergen will not trigger any reactions, but if there is subsequent exposure to the allergen, that is from the second dose, once you expose to that allergen, these mast cells and basophils which are already sensitized will disintegrate and release massive amounts of histamine. Okay, that will cause the allergic reactions. So this is behind the pathophysiology. Then coming to the diagnosis, there are distinctly three types of allergic reactions. The first allergic reaction is localized, right? It doesn't have any systemic reactions. That means it manifests as skin itching, urticaria, or any localized skin rashes. There is no systemic. In this case, you can give the oral antihistamines like diphenhydramine tablet by oral route. It is enough. The second allergic reaction is delayed and systemic. That means the skin rashes or skin itching is generalized, not a localized one. In this case, we can give injectable antihistamines, that is intravenous antihistamines, diphenhydramine or chlorpheniramine we can give. The dosages we have already discussed, right? The third one is immediate systemic reactions. This is called as anaphylaxis, right? Immediate onset systemic reactions with respiratory and cardiovascular effects. In respiratory, you can see the severe dyspnea, right? Difficulty in breathing and bronchospasm leading to the asthmatic like condition, that is difficulty in breathing. In cardiovascular effects, you have hypotension, that is decreased blood pressure. In anaphylaxis cases, first you have to give the epinephrine. After that, you have to give injectable antihistamines. Most of the cases will recover with epinephrine. For sustained action, you have to give the injectable antihistamines and you can give hydrocortisone also. So your first choice of drug is epinephrine. After that, injectable antihistamines and hydrocortisone also you can try for anaphylaxis. That is immediate type of systemic type of allergic reactions. Very much important. Then coming to the asthma. Anxiety, cold or exercises or any allergen. These predisposing factors result in bronchospasm and increased secretions. Asthma is nothing but generalized contraction of smooth muscles in the bronchioles or bronchi, that is lungs, right? Generalized contraction of smooth muscle leading to the difficulty in breathing. Okay, with increased secretion of mucus secretions that will result in again difficulty in breathing, right? So the prominent feature you can see here is wheezing during the inspiration or expiration due to the difficulty in breathing or due to these increased secretions, thick mucus secretions. Wheezing is a prominent sign, and you can see difficulty in breathing and you can see cough also, right? In asthma, the first choice of drug is albuterol, that is salbutamol, that is selective beta 2 agonists. Okay, selective beta 2 agonists, right? These will result in bronchodilation. This is the first choice of drug. If not recovered with albuterol, then you have to go for epinephrine. That is asthma in responsive to albuterol, you have to go for epinephrine. Okay, still not recovered, then third line is aminophylline. Aminophylline given 5 to 10 mg per kg body weight. Aminophylline will result in prompt relief. Definitely the patient will relieve. Okay, after that, for sustained release, sustained action, you can give the hydrocortisone also. Generally, in hydrocortisone is an not a first line of drug because of slow onset, right? So first you have to try albuterol, then epinephrine, then aminophylline, right? Next is airway obstruction due to the foreign body. Okay, these foreign bodies may include crowns or extracted tooth or any food objects, right? So if this airway obstruction is in upper airway or lower airway, in upper airway obstruction only we have symptoms. There is little symptoms in lower airway obstruction, right? So when coming to the symptoms, there is cough. This is weak, ineffective cough. That means in order to expel that, it is a way to expel the obstructed object, right? And there is stridor. This is crowing sound. This is most important feature of any airway obstruction, right? Due to any reason, if there is airway obstruction, you can see the stridor. That is crowing sound on inhalation, inspiration or expiration like that. And difficulty in respiration, right? And then how will you manage? First step is to back slaps. Okay, you can lean the patient and provide powerful back slaps. With that, sometimes object may expel. Okay, if the patient is a children or is a child, then you can hang him upside down. Okay, with that some objects may get expelled. If that is failed, then you are going to do the finger swipes. That is, using your fingers, you have to swipe in the oropharynx region so that any objects can come out. Okay, if you have access to the Magill's forceps or laryngoscope, then you can use those forceps also. Magill's forceps are somewhat long forceps so that you can catch the object and you can remove that. Okay, if these are not available, the next is to do the Heimlich maneuver. Okay, this maneuver is very much important. You have to stand behind the patient and you have to grasp your hands, both hands, which is placed approximately in the xiphoid region, that is below the sternum, right? Below the sternum, you have to grasp your both hands and the thumb side of the fist should be facing the patient. So you have to like this and make sudden upward thrust, upward and inward thrust, so that lungs are compressed between the rib cage. Okay, so this procedure utilizes the residual amount of air which are there in the lung. Okay, in the lung there is residual amount of air. So when you do this inward and upward thrust, the lungs are compressed so that the air pressure in the bronchioles or trachea increases. Due to that air pressure, any foreign body obstruction will be expelled. Okay, so this is Heimlich maneuver. You can do this procedure when the patient is standing, or if the patient is lying, then you have to place your fist in the abdomen, upper abdomen region, and the same thing, inward and upward thrust. Okay, with that thrust you can expel the body. This is Heimlich maneuver. If it is this procedure also failed, then you have to go for surgical intervention. That means surgically you have to make an opening in the airway. The most simplest and emergency procedure is cricothyroidectomy. That means preparing a window or preparing a opening in the cricothyroid membrane, which is located between the thyroid and cricoid cartilages. Okay, this is the simplest and quickest procedure to open the airway, cricothyroidectomy. Or if you have time and it is not that much emergency, then you can go for tracheostomy. Okay, tracheostomy, that is opening in the trachea. You can do both these procedures as a surgical intervention. This is how the step-by-step procedure we have to expel the foreign body, right? After that we have adrenal insufficiency, that is adrenal crisis. This is nothing but, this happens in the patients of history of corticosteroid usage. Okay, the underlying pathophysiology is that generally, normally, what happens when you are exposed to stress, then hypothalamus will release corticotropic releasing hormone, that is CRH. Okay, CRH. This hormone acts on anterior pituitary gland to release ACTH, that is adrenocorticotropic hormone. This ACTH acts on adrenal cortex to release cortisol. So this cortisol helps to cope up with the stressful conditions. That is, in stressful conditions we have increased cortisol levels. Generally this is what happens in our body, but due to the exogenous supply of corticosteroids, that means patient, if he use exogenous corticosteroids, then this internal mechanism gets disturbed. Okay, so there is suppression of this HPA axis. HPA nothing but hypothalamus, anterior pituitary P, and A, adrenal cortex. This HPA axis gets suppressed. So in stressful condition there is no production of endogenous cortisol. So in order to cope up stressful situation, there is no increased levels of cortisol in the body. That will lead to the adrenal insufficiency or crisis. So there is something called as rule of two. That means if the patient has taken more than 20 mg of corticosteroid per day, first condition, more than 20 mg per day, and the second condition is he has taken continuously for more than 2 weeks, especially by the parenteral route. Okay, and the third condition is within 2 years of dental therapy. In these cases, there are high chances of adrenal insufficiency. This is called as rule of two. More than 20 mg per day for continuously 2 weeks. Okay, after that, within 2 years of dental therapy. That is called as rule of two. And in these cases, there is high chances of adrenal insufficiency. So clinically, you can see anxiousness, unconsciousness, and shock or hypotension. Okay, especially shock and hypotension are the more prominent features. So how will you treat? Simple. You have to give the corticosteroids. Hydrocortisone, 100 mg. You can give intramuscular or intravenous injections. Right? After that, you can give the epinephrine also in order to counteract this hypotension. Okay? So hydrocortisone or epinephrine. This is the management.